Good morning, church. It is a wonderful privilege that God has given to all of us again that we could be back meeting through this virtual platform. I'm excited for this morning service. I just want to say this one particular verse in Psalm that fascinates me all the time. You know, that is Psalm 23, especially the verse that says, "Even though I walk through the valley of shadow and death," this verse did not say, "Even though I hear about the valley, even though I see the valley, even though I perceive this valley." No, no, no. It says, "Even though I walk through," meaning God allows a person to go through a valley or a shadow experience. But the beauty of that particular verse lies in the second part of this very verse. "I will not fear because His rod and His staff will comfort me." Because my God's presence and providence and safety is there, therefore I will not be troubled, I will not be disturbed by whatever valley or shadow that comes before me. With that very word, I just want to say, whatever your valleys and shadows are, God's presence and God's providence and mercy and safety and grace is with us. Therefore, we do not need to be afraid. With that one thought, I just want to welcome everyone to this new Calvary Church service. Now it's a time to praise God and sing and to adore and lift His holy name. May I request the worship team right now to lead us in a time of worship, and then we'll take it further.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Calvary Church. This morning, I don't know who needs to hear this, but if you're feeling insecure and you're feeling you're left all alone, I have a good news for you. Jeremiah 31:3 says, "I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have continued my faithfulness in you." Church, His everlasting love is loyal, and it is way beyond our imagination. And the good news is, even death cannot separate us from His love. Death has no dominion over those who love Him and those who are loved by God. Remember, you're not out of His sight, and you're always safe and secure in His palm. His love for you will never change according to your sin. And this morning, He wants you to know that you're very special to Him. Having this thought in our mind, let's sing a few songs for the glory of God.
Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the constant in the trial and the change, this one thing remains, this one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Never runs out on me. Your love never gives up and never runs out on me. And
Isaiah 54 verse 10 says, "Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed."
Will be stripped away.
Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for this precious time that you have given us. Thank you for the opportunity to serve you and to worship you. Lord, help us to always remember the biggest sacrifice that you have done on the cross for us. Thank you for the everlasting love. And help us also to share this love with the people around us. I commit the rest of the time in your mighty hand. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I hope and I believe that you have enjoyed our worship time as the songs that have been played, and you have really sang along and you really meant every word that you said it at this time. And thank you, worship team, for a meaningful time of worship. Now we are going to listen to the Word of God. Last week we looked at the supremacy and superiority of Jesus, that been looking about the angels and about Moses. And as we come to this particular chapter, may I invite Reverend Rajesh to come forward and deliver as the Word of God. Over to Reverend Rajesh.
Good morning, church. Last few weeks, we have been learning from the book of Hebrews. Last week, we have learned from Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Today, we would be discussing Hebrews 3, verses 7 to 11. I have entitled my sermon as Warning to Come Out of Our Legacy of Unbelief and Disobedience. Warning to Come Out of Our Legacy of Unbelief and Disobedience. During this pandemic situation, we all know that human race has been going through an unprecedented crisis. How did we respond? Did anyone forsake their faith? Anyone went into apostasy? Many post-COVID worship services were conducted with empty chairs. People lost their interest in attending the fellowship meetings. Many pastors stopped their church services and started searching other jobs. Many pastors, they lost their jobs as the full-time pastors. Many pastors lost their congregation. Many doors of the churches are still closed. What is God's message to us? I'll just read Hebrews 3:7-1 for you. So, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. During the time of testing in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested and tried me, though for 40 years they saw what I did. That is why I was angry with that generation. I said, their hearts are always going astray. They have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. Do not harden our hearts. Do not rebel against God. Do not murmur against God. You may become the loser, losing the rest, losing the eternal rest. Author of Hebrews speaks of the superiority of Christ in everything. In the chapter 1, the beginning, verses 1 to 4, we have seen the revelation of Christ as final and ultimate. It is the climax of God's progressive revelation. Christ is ultimate and Christ is everything. Everything fulfilled through Christ. Chapter 192, where we have seen Christ as superior to angels. Chapter 3 speaks about Christ as superior to Moses. While exemplifying Christ's superiority over Moses, author of Hebrews takes us through the historic legacy of disobedience of Israelites and reiterates the warning the scripture continues to give. Yes, Moses was faithful to God, but the whole Israelites were not. The response of people towards Moses during the crisis, that of rebellion, disobedience, and unbelief that resulted in denying the rest, that is, entering the promised land. We will look into the warning the author of Hebrews gives to us on how to come out of our legacy of unbelief and disobedience. First and foremost, common legacy of humankind, unbelief and disobedience to God. Romans 1:25. It says like this: they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Common legacy of humankind, unbelief and disobedience to God. Apostle Paul speaks about the legacy of humankind to deny God and His power. Failure to acknowledge God and glorify Him. Even though God made Himself plain from every sense, from the very beginning of creation, that we have ignored Him, we have denied Him, we try to suppress the truth of God. Since the creation, this is our legacy, to ignore, to suppress, and deny the truth of God. And we have promoted the lie that we ourselves are gods, and we can live without God. And we think that humankind has reached a zenith, that we don't need God anymore. This is heritage we have acquired from our forefathers. This is our legacy. Ultimately, we exchange the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and saved the created things rather than the Creator. The common legacy of humankind, unbelief and disobedience to God. Secondly, the historic legacy of Israel's unbelief and rebellion during the Exodus period. The historic legacy of Israel's unbelief and rebellion during the Exodus period. History of Israel is a repetition of God's deliverance and subsequent denial of God. Whenever Israel was in danger, they cried out to the Lord, and Lord rescued them. Within few years, they forgot their God and started following other gods. They turned to idolatry, intermarriage. Then the enemies suppressed them. Then they cried out. These episodes repeated throughout their history. Hebrews 3:7-11 is a repetition of Psalms 95, which refers to the legacy of their disobedience. This is a very peculiar passage, which has recorded an incident referred somewhere else. The incident happened in Exodus and in Numbers. It was referred by Psalmist. Again, Psalmist was quoted by author of Hebrews. This is a very rare passage and a rare incident which is quoted third time. Hebrews 3:5 says, Moses was faithful, but unfortunately, the Israelites were not faithful. They were faithless, so they could not enter into the promised land. We see here the unbelief of Israelites and God's continued protection and providence. Let's see a series of incidents happened during Exodus. Exodus 13:17 says like this. When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not let them on the road through the Philistine country, though that was shorter. For God said, if they face war, they may change their minds and return to Egypt. The reason why the Lord has taken them through a longer route was for their good. They should not get scared by the Philistines and war. They should not feel like returning back. So God took them through a different route. Remember, my brothers and sisters, when God takes you through a different and difficult route, kindly be understand that it is ultimately for our own good. When God takes you through a seems to be kind of different route, God is protecting you from a worse situation. The first challenge they had to face, Exodus 14:10, between Pharaoh and Red Sea. Yes, Israel has started their journey. They have started facing challenges one by one. In every situation, God comes to their rescue and help them to move forward. Rather than affirming their faith, their unbelief, murmuring, and rebelliousness keep on increased. Exodus 14:10 says like this, as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. Yes, it's a very genuine fear. Any person can understand. Verse 11 and 10, if you read, they said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die. What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us save Egyptians? It would have been better for us to save the Egyptians than to die in the desert. Their words were a kind of cursing God. These were the people who have experienced God's protection during Passover. They have seen all these plagues until the death of firstborn of Egyptians. But still God gave them the solution. Yes, what is God's solution? Verse 13, Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm. You will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Egyptian you see today, you will never see again." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. Raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide the water so that Israelites can go through the sea on the dry ground." Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their right and on their left. Yes, rest is history. Egyptians wanted to follow them, but including Pharaoh and his chariot was succumbed in Red Sea. Israelites passed through it, but Pharaoh and Egyptians died. The second challenge they faced was Mara into sweet, Exodus 15:23-25. They encountered with bitter water. Verse 23 onwards says like this, "When they came to Mara, they could not drink its water because it was bitter." That is why the place is called Mara. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" They have reached Mara, the water was bitter to drink. Here also, instead of trying to figure out the solution, they started grumbling against Moses. Verse 25, "Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became fit to drink." Here also their faith should have been increased, right? But what happened next? Now they are facing yet another challenge. From the issue of water to the issue of food. Third challenge, manna and quail. Exodus 16, verse 2 onwards. "In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, 'If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death.'" Had they grateful to God for his faithfulness, they would not have grumbled against God again. The way they are expressing themselves, that as if they were living in the palace of Pharaoh, forgetting the suffering and the pain of working under the Egyptian supervisors. God patiently listened to them and given solution to their issue of food. God gave them manna and quail. Verse 4 onwards, we will see that. Again, now they are encountering next challenge. Quarreling with Moses again on water. Exodus 17:2. "So they quarreled with Moses and said, 'Give us water to drink.' Moses replied, 'Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord into test?' But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, 'Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock to die of thirst?' People continued with boast on past glory, which has never been there. As a solution to the issue. Verse 5, the Lord answered Moses, go out in front of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel and take in your hand the staff which you have struck the Nile and go. I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it for the people to drink. So Moses did this in the sight of elders of Israel. And he called the place Massah and Meribah, because Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? Moses called this place Massah and Meribah. What is the meaning of Massah? Testing. Meribah means rebellion. As they tested and quarreled against God. So there we see Massah and Meribah, testing and quarreling against God. Again, the final challenge we see in the book of Numbers, chapter 20, verse 2 onwards. Here also issue is, there is no water. Chapter 20, verse 2 says like this, now there was no water for the community, and the people gathered in opposition to Moses and Aaron. They quarreled with Moses and said, if only we had died when our brothers fell dead before the Lord. But God says in verse 8 to Moses like this, as a response to them, take the staff and your brother Aaron, gather the assembly together, speak to that rock before they rise, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community, so they and their livestock can drink. God asked Moses to speak to the rock. But what did Moses do out of anger? Verse 11, it says like this. Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and the livestock drank. God asked him something, and he did something else. He struck the rock. They have received the result, but he has violated God's command. So in verse 12 and 13 says like this, but the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. These are the waters of Meribah, where the Israelites quarreled with the Lord and where he was proved holy among them. Due to disobedience of Moses, when he could not lead the people into the promised land, God hates rebelliousness and murmuring. This is a warning to each and every one of us. We need to be careful in our words and actions. We may lose God's best for us. Our rebelliousness and unbelief may take us away from God's blessing. I may lose what is in God's stock for me. Thirdly, warning by Psalmist during our continued pilgrimage. Psalm 95. Reminders of Israelites' rebellion in the desert. Psalmist warns this in the setting of worship. If we read Psalm 95 starts with, come, let us sing of joy to the Lord. It continues in the mood of worship till verse 7a. But second part onwards, the tone changes from worship to warning. 95:8 says like this, do not harden your heart as you did at Meribah, as you did at Massah. Psalmist reminds the history and the legacy of rebellion and testing. It continues where your fathers tested. The legacy of rebellion continues even during the time of Psalmist. Maybe he is mentioning the rebellion against God during the monarchy. the kings went after other gods, allowed the idol worshippers. They have entered into intermarriages. So the psalmist reminded them of the legacy of unbelief and disobedience to God. Verse 10 says like this, for 40 years I was angry with that generation. See, initially we have seen, you know, God took them through a longer route to help them out. But later on, in Numbers, while they were about to enter into Canaan, God says like this, Numbers 14:2, all the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader and go back to Egypt. When they continued their rebellion, God said that none of you will enter the land except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, son of Nun. None of you will enter into the land except Caleb and Joshua. But as for you, your bodies will fall in this wilderness. Your children will be shepherds here for 40 years, suffering for your unfaithfulness, until the last of your bodies lies in the wilderness. For 40 years, 1 year for each of the 40 days, you explore the land. You will suffer for your sins and know that what it is like to have me against you. So that is the kind of God's punishment to them. So finally, Psalm 95:11 says like this, so I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter into my rest. Yes, they have lost the opportunity to enter into the promised land. This warning continues through the psalmist that to persevere our faith, not to rebel, not to be disobedient. And fourthly, we see warning by author of Hebrews to Jews and Christians. We need to follow good examples. We need to unfollow the bad examples as well. The example of disgrace. There are many bad examples that will take us away from the Lord. We take some of them as an excuse to follow the Lord. Hebrews 3:7 to 11 is sandwiched between two verses. We have verse 6, says like this, we are his house if we hold on to our courage and hope of which we boast. It is an appeal to hold on courage and hope. Appeal to hold on. Verse 12, it says, none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. Drop down, sinful, unbelieving heart. Drop down the sinful, unbelieving heart. Hold on to something and drop down something. Hold on to the hope and drop down the unbelieving heart. In this sandwich, we have all the warning. Hebrews 3:7 starts like this. Today God is still speaking. Someone greater than angels and Moses. All the readers are reminded of God's call when God's voice is heard. The heart should be responsive and not to be hardened. In scripture, heart refers to mind. Spirit continues to speak to subsequent generations of Christians through the scripture, warning them to make each day afresh. Today, each day God may speak, and each day God may be resisted, but he may also be accepted. And Hebrews continues, tested and tried. They are the proper nouns, Meribah and Massah. It all refers to what had happened in Numbers. Their hardening of the heart for 40 years costed them a lot. They have lost their rest. Although Hebrews finds a typical resemblance between the rebellion of Israelites during Exodus and the Jews who opposed Jesus during that point of time. So the warning is applicable for both the Jews and the Christians of the day. Due to their continuous unbelief and rebelliousness, God has grieved with that generation. So finally, verse 11 says, I swore in my wrath, shows the intensity and the depth of God's displeasure. Hebrews 10:31 says like this, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hand of the living God. Yes, Christian life is a pilgrimage. Early Christians were in a pilgrimage to reach the ultimate rest. They were supposed to carry on by holding on their hope and drop down their unbelieving heart. So it's a warning. And finally, we see a greater warning. Our legacy of unbelief and disobedience during our pilgrimage. A greater warning. Our legacy of unbelief and disobedience during our pilgrimage. What was the problem with the Israelites? They doubted God's presence. Is the Lord among us? They doubted God's ability. Is God powerful enough to meet our need? God was deeply grieved by the people's doubt and disloyalty, and swore that they would not enter into the land of rest. Yes, we are on a pilgrimage. What are the uniqueness of pilgrimages? I would say there is a splendid beginning, a spectacular beginning. If it is by some celebrities, there will be lots of celebration. There will be people to see off. There will be people to accompany them. Christian life is also similar to that. A very good start. An overflowing joy and happiness. Fellowship with the children of God. Think that Christian life is bed full of roses. But soon, we will find some or other struggles, oppositions, disappointments, discouragements, miscommunications with the fellow believers. As a result, some of them will start backsliding. Some of them will drop off. Some of them will discontinue their faith. And end result is many will fail to reach the destiny. We have a common saying, well begun, half done. But in the Christian life, finishing well is as important as the beginning. Our Lord Jesus said at the end of his life, on the cross he said, it is finished. Whatever the mission is laid upon him, he could finish, he could complete. Hebrews 13:7 says like this, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Paul says like this at the end of his life in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race and I have kept the faith. So our end is very important as a beginning. We should be able to finish well. We have a very classical book called Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan. There in the book, the Christian starts his pilgrimage from the city of destruction, that is this world, to the celestial city, heaven. He faces lots of temptations, worldly wisdom. And when he looked back, many have perished. But finally, he reaches the destiny. So here we see in this pilgrim's progress, many people, they could not finish. They could not reach till the end. Yes, many could not finish the pilgrimage. We have a legacy of those who discontinue their faith. Even in our churches, we have now called seasonal Christians. We have many seasonal Christians, even in the churches, active in the faith for some time, active in the church, active in the choir, active in youth fellowship, then completely disappears. After a few months, after a few years, they would come back again. Many of their commitment to the Lord is seasonal. There is no consistency in their walk with the Lord. And there is something else called subscriptions. We have different levels of subscription of magazines. People subscribe for 1 year, subscribe for 2 years, and some of them are having live subscription. Many are subscribers for a time. Christian life is not a subscription for a limited period of time, but it is a pilgrimage with the Lord. We are journeying with the Lord till the end. Challenge before us is continuity in Christian faith. We know a beautiful song, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." It says like this, "I have decided to follow Jesus, not turning back and not turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow, not turning back, not turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me, not turning back, not turning back." About 150 years ago, in Garo Hills, that is presently in the Meghalaya state, the American Baptist Missionary Societies, they came and they started doing the mission work. The missionary, he could convert a man, his wife, and his 2 children. And due to his conversion, many villages started accepting Christ. But the village chief, he got very angry, and he called all the villagers, and he also called this converted family as well. And here, he started asking question to this person. But this person said, "I have decided to follow Jesus." The village chief, he got very angry. And he told his archers to arrow down the 2 children. And so they did. And he lost his 2 children. This chief asked him, "Will you deny your faith? You have lost both your children. You will lose your wife too now." The man replied, "Though no one joins me, still I will follow." The chief ordered his wife to be arrowed down, and they did so. "Now," he asked for the last time, "I'll give you one more opportunity. Deny your faith and live." He replied, "The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back." He was also arrowed down like rest of his family. But their deaths took a miraculous turn. The chief who ordered the killing of this family, he started wondering, why should this man, his wife, and his 2 children die for a man who lived and died 2,000 years ago? There must be something remarkable power behind this family faith. So now he declared, "I too belong to Jesus Christ." When the crowd heard this from the mouth of their chief, the whole village accepted Christ as their Savior and Lord. "I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow, no turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me, No turning back. No turning back. The challenges would be big or small, COVID or non-COVID, job or joblessness, life or death. Would you continue to trust in Him? We have been receiving so many reminders. In the West, they say, we live in a post-Christian era. Many lost their faith. Many of the so-called Christian nations are filled with non-religious secularists. Many have become agnostics. They say, I'm not aware whether there is God. Even if He is there, I have nothing to do with them. Let us break the legacy of unbelief. Let us take the warning seriously. Let us not harden our heart. Let us not lose the feeble voice of Holy Spirit whispering into our hearts. Let us renew our trust in the Lord. Let us be persistent in our faith. Let us not make any fatal kind of mistakes in our life. We are privileged members of God's house. But my dear brothers and sisters, it is not unconditional. Hebrews 3:14 says like this, we certainly share its security and favors, but with one warning. Only if you hold fast our confidence firm till the end. Only if you hold fast our confidence firm till the end. May God bless us.
Christ is my reward. Dear Church, I publish the banns of marriage between Miss Jianlu Gangmai, spinster, daughter of Mrs. Daisy, and Mr. Damsing Gangmai, member of New Calvary Church, Chennai, and Mr. Paujik Lung Kame, bachelor, son of Mrs. Namkonliu, and Mr. K. Lunghai, member of New Calvary Church, Chennai. If any of you know just cause why these two persons should not be joined together in marriage, you have to declare it in writing to the pastor in charge of this congregation. This is the first time of asking.
Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Blessed Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that we live in a world which are filled with challenges. Many people lose their faith in you, but still we want to affirm our faith in you, Lord. We want to follow you and you alone. No turning back. Lord, we pray that you would grant us your grace and wisdom to hold on our faith till the end, understanding that you are superior, you are everything. There is none beside thee and there is none beyond thee, so that we would continue our faith till the end and we would be able to receive the final rest in you. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Now receive the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of Father and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen.